Marsha de Cordova has resigned as Shadow Equalities Secretary in the most high-profile resignation yet from Starmer's top team. De Cordova announced her resignation in a tweet. She wrote, "It has been an immense privilege to serve as the Shadow Women and Equalities Secretary for the past 17 months. It therefore comes with much sadness that I am resigning with immediate effect." Having only been elected in 2017 for the historically marginal constituency of Battersea, I would like to focus more of my time and efforts on the people of Battersea. I will continue to support Keir Starmer from the backbenches. That tweet doesn't make the resignation sound particularly contentious. That was a very polite resignation tweet, but according to an article in The Voice, there were political disagreements underlying de Cordova's decision. They report. Associates of Battersea MP claim that the party failed to put her on a single media round during 17 months in the job, and that she was offered just 5 minutes speaking time at Labour's annual conference, which takes place next week. Sources said that efforts to set up a task force of experts to design progressive race equality policy were held back over concerns this might upset Red Wall voters, and that Starmer had resisted pleas to make a speech setting out his vision to black communities. They also quote a friend of de Cordova, who told The Voice, "It's been bubbling for a while. She just wasn't being supported. And the bottom line was you can only do so much before it becomes difficult. And it did become very difficult. She always had a goal that she wanted Keir to speak authentically about race. And despite her trying, it just was never going to happen. Marsha wanted to develop Labour's vision for race equality, but kept meeting stumbling blocks. Even to just put out comments on things, it was watered down. You know, challenging the Prime Minister, you're not allowed to do that. It's the people around Starmer, his team. They don't understand race or the importance of it." Aaron, I want your thoughts on this. This resignation hasn't received too much coverage in the press. You might think this would, you know, create some negative coverage around Keir Starmer. It hasn't really made a ripple. Do you think this is a big deal?
You know, it is a big deal. And it's also because it's part of a broader pattern. And people might not know that because it's barely being talked about. You had, about a year ago now, Emma Hardy pulled back from the shadow cabinet to focus on her constituency. It's in Hull, I believe. It's a Leave voting constituency. The reason why is because she thinks she might lose it. You're going to see that more and more. Then a few weeks ago, you saw something similar with Luke Pollard taking a step back. You're seeing Marsha, these are all for different reasons, of course. Now you're seeing Marsha de Cordova stepping back. You're seeing moves with Charlotte Nicholls. I don't quite know the full story here. I've not heard the full story, but she's been moved effectively by mutual agreement, as I understand it. And what this would suggest to you is the poor polling, the sort of enmity towards Keir Starmer from big parts of the membership, not all of it, but from big parts of the membership. And then you've got people who should be your allies. You know, Marsha de Cordova, she nominated Keir Starmer to be Labour leader. You know, she's on the left, but she nominated Keir Starmer to be Labour leader. And as I understand it, her major misgivings about Starmer are, as identified in this Voice article, one, he's nowhere on race. Absolutely nowhere on race. And then two, he is kind of apparently, or the people around him, and you know, people always say the people around him as if it's some sort of some court, you know, the monarch's never to blame, it's always the courtiers. They want to basically just completely eviscerate the left and get them out of the party. That's their number one priority. And I think for anybody who looks at the climate, who looks at Black Lives Matter, who looks at the housing crisis, who looks at COVID-19, that is insane. It looks ridiculous and crazy. They don't want to be a part of that. And I don't think you have to be on the left or, you know, a radical to think that. And so I think Marsha saw that. She saw the race stuff. And I think she's taking a step back. And I don't think she'll lose her seat. But I think that seat in Battersea wasn't Labour until 2017. So she will have to work to keep it. And, you know, people think, oh, well, Starmer's going to keep all of Labour's voters from 2019. In big cities, I personally don't think he will. And I think she'll have a reduced majority. And so I think there's that calculus too, like with Emma Hardy. So we'll see. I think it is a big story. Because I think if you've got people who 2 years out from an election that's looking like 2023 are already saying, I can't serve in the shadow cabinet, well, you get quite a small talent pool in the end for Labour. And I think that plus the race side of this, big story. And again, you know, this stuff just isn't being covered by The Guardian, by the liberal left press, because they don't really care. They don't really care about these things, just like they don't really care about climate change, quite frankly. So yeah, but it is, I think it is a big story. And I think I think something's going on under the surface, Michael. I think there's many, many, many people in the Parliamentary Labour Party have big misgivings about Starmer and the people around him, particularly on policy, particularly on comms. You've had the whole team effectively swept out after Batley and Spen. People don't really know who these other people are. And if you're in a constituency with a 1,500, 2,000 majority, you're going to be thinking, oh, these people might lose me my job. And I think there's a lot of MPs thinking like that right now.
On the one hand, I think the reason, the Guardian, et cetera, aren't making a big deal about this is because they don't enjoy criticizing Keir Starmer in the same way they enjoy criticizing Jeremy Corbyn. At the same time, you might ask, if Marcia Del Cordova has these critiques, why not include that in the tweet? You know, because it would have been harder to ignore then, wouldn't it? So I don't know, what do you think about that? Why do you think we've got this situation where the Voice have been briefed that this was about political disagreements, and then the MP has officially said, oh, actually, this is because I want to spend more time in my constituency. How would someone make sense of that?
Well, the way I read it is, and this could be wrong, you know, she's only been an MP for 4 years. People say Starmer's inexperienced. She's only been an MP for 4 years. And I think she resigned. She didn't want it to be messy. I think it's easy if you're just basically seeking re-election, go to the backbenches. You don't want to cause a drama. But the reality is, if you resign, if you don't say why you've resigned, people will create reasons as to why you've resigned. And you have to say why you've resigned. So you get claims about, well, it was racism. Oh, it's because she's on the left. It's because of LGBT stuff. As I understand, it's got nothing to do with LGBT stuff. I mean, I might be wrong. But like you say, she's not directly stated why she's leaving. My understanding is about Starmer's position on race and the fact that basically the people around him aren't serious about power. They're serious about eviscerating the left. But like you say, I think she should state it quite clearly. You don't need to be mean and aggressive and belligerent. But like I say, if you don't give your reasons, somebody else will. And they may not be true. So you need to tell your own side of the story.